earliest memories I have right on through, and it's just almost every bit of it just been wonderful. I guess one of the, if I had to pick four or five moments in my life that were just the mountaintop, we had prayed and prayed and planned, and we'd heard every negative thing you could hear about trying to reestablish a church in Thessalonica. And just about everybody that we mentioned it to said it couldn't be done for this reason or that reason. And that's pretty much all we'd heard. And then the Lord put it on Angelo's heart and Brent's heart to go there and establish themselves in that city. That's a big breakthrough. But you still don't know. And I tell you, we got in that van with Alabama plates on it and rode through that city and went to that great, great square and got out there and looked at each other. And no point in sticking your toe in the water. Let's just jump in. We began to sing and began to preach, and the police didn't move, and the priest didn't move, and the crowds began to gather, and the people began to come. I'm telling you, that moment is like, God, there will be a church in this city. That's such a wonderful hour, one of the greatest hours of my life. I got to spend it with Brent there, and what a blessing. Church is doing well. Thessalonica, the Brent Logan Memorial Church, Thessaloniki. Is that what they named it? That church right there in that city where there hadn't been one in all those years. Not many towns God wrote two letters to. And, there's a church there now, and Brent and his family had such a big part in that and so instrumental in that work. And I'm glad I can look back in the great moments in my life centered around serving God. The ones above the water, centered around serving God. The ones under the water, that's just praising God. But Brent's been a part of a lot of those, and he's been a real good friend and a blessing. He's the handsome Logan. You're welcome. Come ahead, brother. Amen. Brother Brent Logan pastors the Liberty. I know it's Prince of the Liberty Pentecostal Holiness Church, Mount Pleasant, South Carolina, just outside of Charleston, and we're glad he's there. Amen. Thank you, brother.
All right, great to be back in this oasis in the desert of truth in this country. Good to be back here and with my friend that I pay to make good compliments about me like that. So good to be saved. Good to be in the Bible. Center our thoughts around the Lord. Well, my text this morning, of course, is the phrase, and you already know what it is, where it says about the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is the prince of the kings of the earth. The prince of the kings of the earth. Go to Acts chapter 5 with me. Acts chapter 5. We'll start there. There's so many facets and views and things about the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's easy to get focused just on one characteristic of the Lord, just like it is in Christianity. And one of the problems of Christianity today is that people overemphasize one thing to the detriment of something else. But the Lord Jesus Christ is everything he needs to be. He's all things. He's not mainly one thing, he's many things. In our mind's eye, if we look at Acts chapter 5, the Bible says here in verse 29, you know the verse where the Bible says, "Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, 'We ought to obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree, him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins, and we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him. You know, we would emphasize the fact that the Lord God raised Jesus Christ to be our Savior. We would look at that in a, if you could say, a selfish way. That's what we're interested in, that God raised him up to be a Savior. But that's not the first in the list in Acts chapter 5, verse 31. It says, him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a Savior. In other words, there's more to Jesus Christ than just saving poor sinners. Thank God that he saves poor sinners. But he is not only a Savior, he is also a prince. A prince. And that's the characteristic that we want to look at today in Revelation 1:5. He is the prince of the kings of the earth. I could find really about five princely titles for the Lord Jesus Christ. And really, I just have two main points, and I've got to begin. I don't want to do it. And I'm going to confess my sin beforehand, publicly, and then afterward I will get right with your pastor. But, you know, as we try to really study and we get into something and we meditate and we read all the references, when I was thinking about a prince, all I could think about, I'm sorry, brother, was Walt Disney. And it just, in my brain, I kept hearing that strange, squeaky, weird song. Someday my prince will come. Someday we'll meet again. And away to his castle we'll go. To be happy forever. I know. And a continue. You want me to give you the rest of it? Someday when spring is here, we'll find our love anew and the birds will sing and the wedding bells will ring. Someday when my dreams come true, the prince is the dream that I want, that I'm interested in, that I love, that my affections are toward. The strange thing, and pray for me, this is not the first Walt Disney problem that I've had. It's some kind of relapse from childhood. I preached not long ago in church. I was trying to really give the people the Word of God. And I'm preaching a series of messages in the church on Daniel and how we need to be like Daniel. And I preached the first chapter about what was Daniel's main characteristic that we need was his heart. And in chapter 2, the main characteristic of Daniel was his mind. He had a quick mind to come when the king was going to kill all the wise men. He had a mind to step in there and God helped him figure the dream out. And then the third message I got up to preach and I looked at my notes and I said the third thing about Daniel, I went over to the sixth chapter, I said is he had courage, and I stopped myself and I said, oh my Lord, I'm preaching the Wizard of Oz. What? He needed a heart and he needed a brain and he needed courage. And I publicly said that and I said, I'm sorry. But the funny thing was, after the service, a man came up to me and he said, don't worry about it, preacher. The greatest message I ever preached was on the three pigs. That's true. That's true. I promise that. But a prince is really someone that should garner all the affections and dreams and love. And Jesus is that prince. He's that prince that has the forever. He's that prince that should be all of your dreams. Rick Baker said when he got up to preach last night to begin with, and I wrote it down, he said, if you would just fall head over heels in love with Jesus, who knows what God would do? If he would be your prince. If he would be your desire. And we have some kind of strange replacement therapy that, and people in life, they dream of the perfect man or the perfect woman, and then they find out that doesn't exist. Right? Or the perfect life or the perfect child, and they wrap up all their affections in things that just continually disappoint. But I'm going to tell you what, there is a real prince. And the Bible says that that prince is worth so much. You know, the Bible called David a prince. And they loved David so much that they came to David and said, you're worth 10,000 of us. That they loved him so much, you're worth 10,000 of us. We don't want anything to happen to you. Because you're our prince and you're our love and you have our affections. And we love you more than we love ourselves. We love you more than we love our lives. You're our prince. There was another Solomon, or David's son Solomon, the great prince, and the song of which is Solomon's, the song of songs. In other words, the greatest love song you can sing, the song of songs, which is Solomon's. And over you hear the declaration of one that is extolling her affection for her prince, for the one that she loves. And she says, the voice, you know, the voice of my beloved. And my beloved spake and said unto me, rise up my love. And she's overwhelmed. My fair one, come away. She said, he's the chiefest among 10,000s. And his head is the most fine gold. And his eyes are the eyes of doves. And his lips are like lilies. And his hands are gold rings. And his legs are pillars of marble on sockets of fine gold. And his mouth is most sweet. And he's altogether lovely. This is my beloved and this is my friend. That's not a love story or a marriage seminar. That's a real prince. I wonder who's your prince and who you love and where are your affections this morning? Is he the prince of your life? But that's the first word, is the word affection. The second word that I think about, and go to Proverbs 14. When I think about the word prince, I think about the word authority. A prince is defined by his authority. Proverbs chapter 14. We've got to clear up something, because in our modern day minds, we have a difference in our mind between a prince and a king. Normally, someone would think a prince is a king in waiting or a king's son, but not a king. That's not true for several reasons. I mean, it can be true, but in the very definition of what a prince is, that's not true. And I know that I'll spit some verses out while you're getting to Proverbs 14. Solomon, while he was a king, was called a prince. 1 Kings 11:34. Jeroboam, as a king, was called a prince. 1 Kings 14:7. Baasha the king was called a prince in 1 Kings 16:2. So the word prince does not mean a lesser title than a king. You need to get that. Prince is not a lesser, I'll try to show you that. Proverbs 14, would you look at it? It's almost a synonymous term, and it speaks of rulership or dominion or authority or power. Proverbs chapter 14, the Bible says, verse 28. Proverbs 14, 28. In the multitude of people is the king's honor, but in the want of people is the destruction of the prince. Look at chapter 25. You'll see this over and over through the Bible. I'll just read a few of them. Proverbs 25, he'll equate the prince and the king in the same verse or the same thought. Proverbs 25 and verse number 6, the Bible says, put not forth thyself in the presence of the king and stand not in the place of great men. For better it is that it be said unto thee, come up hither, than that thou shouldest be put lower in the presence of the prince. See the context. Whom thine eyes have seen. So he's equating one with the other. Look at Isaiah 32. Isaiah 32, one more verse. Isaiah 32 and verse 1. When you think of Jesus Christ as the prince of the kings of the earth, I think of affection, I think of authority. Isaiah chapter 32, verse 1, the Bible says, behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes shall rule in judgment. So a prince is a ruler. I'll give you the definition if you want it. A prince is, quote, the chief of any body of men. A prince is, in a general sense, a sovereign. This is the definition. The chief independent ruler of a nation or state. So a prince just goes to his authority or his rulership. And it could be of a country. It could be of anything. It could be, like in Daniel's case, there was a prince of the eunuchs, right? That means he had authority or he had control or power over all those eunuchs. He was their prince. He was in control of them. Look at Daniel chapter 10. These are not kingdoms as far as we would look at earthly rulership. Look at Daniel chapter 10. I'll start in verse 13, and you'll run into a lot of princes. But these aren't going to be princes in Washington, D.C. These are different princes. And it just goes to the point of their authority in something, their dominion, their power. Daniel chapter 10, the Bible says here in verse 12, then said he unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. Verse 13, but the what? The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief what? Princes came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. You see what's going on? You see how it's equating with this authority and a struggle of authority? Look down at verse 20. Then said he, knowest thou there wherefore I come unto thee, and now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. But I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth, and there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael, your prince. Michael, who's Michael? Michael's an archangel, right? So he's speaking of something more than an earthly authority. He's speaking more of than an earthly battle. He's speaking, there are princes that you can't even see. You say, well, that bothers me. Well, then turn back to chapter 9 of Daniel. The Bible says in chapter 8, about the Antichrist, he's going to magnify himself against the prince of the host. That's pretty strange in verse 11. And then the abomination that maketh desolation, verse 13. And he continues to exalt himself. And the Bible says, verse 23, and in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences shall stand up in his power, shall be mighty, but not by his own power. And he shall destroy wonderfully and shall prosper and practice and shall destroy the mighty and the holy people. And through his policy also, he shall cause craft to prosper in his hand. And he shall magnify himself in his heart and by peace shall destroy many. He shall also stand up against the capital P prince prince. Now here's the first title I can give you. Prince of princes. It don't matter if you got Michael, your prince, or if you got the prince of Greece, or the prince of Persia, or the prince of the Antichrist, or whatever prince you want. He says, put all the princes down, and then there's a prince of the princes. So whatever those earthly authorities, whatever those spiritual authorities are, whatever those fights are going on, whatever those representations of the power of evil, there is a prince of princes, and the Bible says he, that's this other prince, is going to be broken without hand. Go to Romans chapter 8 real quick. Romans chapter 8. Bible says that nothing can separate us from the love of God, right? The love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. He's the prince of princes, and he's got power and authority over all the things that would harm us or keep us from the place that we need to be. And the Bible says in verse 38, you should know the verse, Romans 8, 38, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor, what's the word? Principalities. The word principality has in it this word prince, speaking of the authority or position or power or dominion of some spiritual authority. Look at Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, the Bible says in verse 10. Ephesians 3 verse 10. To the intent, well, look, verse 9. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God who created all things but Jesus Christ. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. The Lord Jesus Christ's authority extends into the principalities. In chapter 2 of Ephesians, he said, in verse 2, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the what? The prince of the power of the air. Wonder who that is. Look at Ephesians chapter 6. He continues that theme when he says in verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities. Powers. Against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Against spiritual wickedness in high places. There are powers. There are authorities. There are spiritual powers. Spirit has nothing to do with a fleshly man. This is a fight with the things of the devil and the powers of the devil. But instead of getting all, you know, it's like that guy came to me and said, I need some, you know, I was trying to counsel the guy and he's just nuts, you know. I mean, you can't counsel people. You can't even talk to people anymore. They're nuts. They're on drugs. They're so far removed. I mean, all you can say is, let's go to church, you know, sit in church. You just sit in church for a year and if you can get help, okay. But, and then maybe I'll talk to you. But until some of that stuff is cleared out, and he said, you know, I talk to the devil and I talk to devils and things like that. And I said, well, you know, talk to whoever you want to, but you better talk to Jesus. I really don't give a flip of what, you know, I don't care. Why? And there's a group of people that are so involved in trying to figure out all these principalities and all this rulers of the darkness of this world. My mind is not on that. My mind is on the prince of those princes that has the authority over that prince of the power of the air. So, there are principalities. We are in a battle, but our eyes need to be kept upon the one that is the prince of all those princes. I'm not going to finish. John chapter 12, I'll read as fast as I can. John chapter 12, the Bible says in verse 31. Now, Jesus said, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Chapter 16 of John, verse 11, the Bible says of Jesus said of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. Bible said in John chapter 14, I missed one. John chapter 14, verse 30. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. There is an authority in this world right now. It's not the Lord Jesus Christ. And the prince of this world is running the show. But there is a prince over that prince. And as bad as it gets, there is another authority over top of his authority. He does have the authority. He's the prince of princes. But my text doesn't say anything about him being the prince over the heavenly princes. It says he's the prince of the kings of the earth. He's over those that claim authority upon this earth. You know, in my mind and in your mind, the first coming of Jesus Christ is so utterly important to us because through that we find the kingdom of the Lord within our hearts. And so that's important to us. But you know, most of the prophetic verses in Scripture don't point to the first coming of Jesus. It points to the second coming of Jesus. Because God, the Father, is interested in all of the earth coming under His authority. That's what God's interested in. Not a mock Savior, but a ruling Savior. The prince of the kings of the earth. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Often, the world, that's all they talk about is the prince of the kings, or they talk about the kings of this earth, when they should be talking about the prince that's over those kings of the earth. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, the Bible says, in verse number 2, "For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." You say, amen. That's what we want to hear about. That's what we want to know about. Look at verse 6. "Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world." He said, I don't want to talk about the princes of the world. I could care less about who's running Rome. I don't care who's running Greece. I don't care who's running the world. He says, they're all come to naught. I'm interested in Jesus Christ because He will not come to naught. He's worthy to talk about. "But we speak the wisdom of God and the mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world into our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew." The princes of this world didn't know the prince that we know, but they're going to find out about Him. Because the last reference of the word prince in the Bible is Revelation chapter 1, verse 5. He's the first, He's the last. He's the final authority. And right now we know the children of Israel are abiding many days without a king, without a prince. But He's coming. And the supreme question of our lives should be, and the supreme question of this world is, who's in charge? And everybody gets so out of shape because the world is out of control. But the world is out of control because Jesus is not in charge of it. They've not been bowing to His authority. But it's sort of dumb to get mad at the world being out of control and not under the authority of Jesus Christ when your life is out of control and your life is not under the authority of Jesus Christ. This world is in rebellion to the prince. Just like a lot of people's lives. Wives, husbands, and rebellion to their prince. Church members in rebellion to their prince. What's the problem? Rebels. The problem is the question of authority. And the struggle is, I want to be in control. And in John chapter 1, in Revelation chapter 1, John falls down at the feet of the prince. I know he falls down at his feet with fear. I know he falls down at his feet because he is awestruck at the majesty and the glory, but he also falls down at his feet because he is in total submission to his prince. Not what I want. Well, what right does Jesus Christ have over all of my life? If Jesus Christ, the only one that can fall on his face and say, not my will, but thine be done, why can we not fall down upon our face before him and say, Lord, whatever you want in my life, whatever you want me to do, whatever you want me to be, I'm not going to call the shots for my life. It's not what I want out of life. I'm underneath your authority. I submit, God. And the problem in our world, in our homes, in our churches, in our lives, is because we have not fallen down before the prince. Praise God, he's got the keys of death and of hell. How about the key to your heart? How about the key to your decisions in life? My prince. Really? There's love and then there's submission. Americans hate that word. You know, we don't like kings. We don't like princes. We don't even like presidents. Right? You can't stand up and say in this world today that a wife needs to submit to her husband, or that somebody should submit to their pastor, or people that should submit to God, or children should submit to their parents, because we have a total rebellious attitude toward authority. But when the Bible talks about Jesus, it's not just talking about a Savior. It's not just talking about grace and mercy. It's talking about a prince that needs and wants control of our lives. And one day he's going to have control of it all. But you know what? I'm not going to wait till the second coming to give it to him. And I'm not going to fight with him over it like the kings of the earth will. They will fight to the last breath to hang on to their authority. And they're going to lose. The prince of princes. The prince of the kings of the earth. Well, the Bible says he's the prince of life. Not just death. He's the prince of life. He has the authority over life. He has the rulership over life. In him was life.
Yes, right.
And that life was the light of men. He owns the control of the realm of life. He is the prince of life. And I'm come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. I've got the water of life. You want it? I've got the bread of life. You want it? I've got the abundant life. Do you want it? I'm the prince of life. If you really want to live, I'm over it. I've got it. I control it. I have dominion over it. And I can pass it out to you. You're not going to find it anywhere else because I'm the prince of life. You can look for life in any other well you want to find, but you're not going to find it because I'm the prince of it. And he's the prince of peace, right? Peace I leave with you. My peace give I unto you. Not as the world giveth. Give I unto you. Where do we go to get peace? We go get peace from the one that's got the authority over it. The prince, the one that's controlling it, the one that holds on to the peace, the one that has dominion over the peace, and the one that can pass out the peace. The prince of the kings of the earth, the prince of peace, the prince of princes, the prince of life. Messiah the Prince. The one that has the anointing, the one that controls the anointing. Messiah the Prince. He's the Prince. And someday he will come. But he's right here now. So why don't you just turn over the keys? You're my Prince. I've had enough of this other prince charming mess. You're my prince. Father, take the word of God. Help us, Lord, to allow you to have the authority over our lives. And may you have the very seat of our affections and love. We love you today. Increase our love, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.